Thank you so much. Thank you, Suresh. This is welcome to you, Leander. I mean, here is a person who really needs no introduction at all, not just in India, but anywhere in the world. He has been one of the most iconic sportspersons that we've had in India, someone that we, all of us, are so proud of. You know, I have personally been an ardent fan of Leander, and he knows it, since I was a lot younger, and so was he. One of the most amazing careers, spanning over literally 3 decades on the professional circuit almost. So it's an absolute honor to have you here today, Leander. We are so you know, here is a person who's actually been known to be as fast as a gazelle on the court and with reflexes of a cheetah. But and he continues to be like that. I mean, it's so amazing to just know that. Welcome, Lalita ma'am. It's so good to see you also. And Lalita ma'am, Leander is the regional director of Sai Sonipat, and she's the one who's been responsible for putting all this together along with her colleague Himanshu, so who's been doing an absolutely fantastic job. So we are really, really happy to have you here today, Leander. We welcome you, and we now hand it over to Suresh to start this second week of our coaches of the Sports Authority of India, All India Tennis Association joint initiative, the sports webinar for coaches. We have another week of absolutely fantastic lectures and also celebrity presences lined up, and we hope to have make a big impact with the coaches. Thank you very much, Suresh. Thank you, Leander, once again, and over to you, Suresh.
Thank you, Vishwadeep.
And Himanshu, can you bring in Manoj Vaidya into the panelists, please? Manoj Vaidya is the CEO of the Maharashtra State Lawn Tennis Association. He's been associated with the coaching, education program for the last 20 years. And he was the first one to be qualified as a level 2 coach in India before all of us did. And he's also a level 3 coach. Manoj, welcome. You can turn on your video and your mic, please. Okay. Good morning, Leander.
Good morning, Suresh. Good morning,
Leander, everybody. Yeah. Leander, you're looking so good. You don't look like a 47-year-old. You look like 25 or something. What is your secret?
I feel like I need a haircut, but with the lockdown.
I think we all do need that. We have a lockdown beard also. Huh?
I can see Manoj and Vishwadeep, sporting the beard. They both look really good. You look.
So, Leander, when you were in, training in Chennai, before we go into that, I wanted to mention something which Sachin Tendulkar once said this, in an interview, that he's so proud to come from the land where Leander Paes comes from. And I don't know if you can get a better compliment than that.
That's very sweet of Sachin to say. A few of us started all in early 1990 with our professional career. There was Vishwanath Anand, who was in college at Loyola College in Chennai, just up the road from where we lived at the BAC program. There was Sachin Tendulkar, Vaishnav Bhutia, and myself.
Okay.
We all started off in the 90s, and I think that mutual respect that we all share is something very special, because we've all had very long careers.
Yeah, absolutely. All of you were just phenomenal.
And, sorry to disturb, but maybe you could be a little bit louder, because, I think, bring this a little closer, because we want to hear you.
Sure.
Thanks.
Yeah. So, Leander, we talk about all the achievements that you've done over the years. It's just phenomenal. And all of us Indians and all the coaches, and especially us, we are so proud of your achievements, and you are kind of the person that people look up to emulate what you've done. And 18 Grand Slams, I don't know if anyone is going to do it anytime soon, but you know, I think they should be trying a lot. So before we go into that, can you tell us a little bit about your early years in Chennai at the Britannium Thrush program, where you had Chandrasekhar as a coach and David Womera as your coach? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yes, the bat program was very important for me because when I was born in Calcutta, growing up in Kolkata with two parents who played team sport, for me, football was my main sport at the time. I grew up more talented at football than I did at tennis. For a few of you all who know me really well, my skills were always with my legs. I've got these big, strong legs that I inherited from my mom and my dad. And bat was so important for me because it taught me the technique of tennis. I think that someone like a Teach Chandrasekhar, someone like a David Omera, Ted Murray, the coaches at bat worked very hard over those 5 years to teach me the technique of forehands and backhands and kick serves and slicers. And, you know, they were very astute in picking up my physical talents and how fast my eye-hand coordination was and how fast my eye-feet coordination was. We knew very earlier on that the strength that I had was more in the mental fitness, in the emotional fitness, in the physical fitness, more than the technique of hitting a perfect backhand. I feel that over time, the Bat Academy also taught me a sense of professionalism. It taught me a sense of how much hard work is needed to be a Grand Slam champion, how much hard work is needed to be an Olympic champion. So I would not be where I am today without T. Chandrasekhar. I would not be where I am today without a Dev Omera or a Ted Murray. To me, my coaches have been my gurus. They have been the ones that have helped me to be who I am today. Whether I look at a Zeeshan Ali, who I grew up with, or whether I look at an Akhtar Ali, Anwar Ali, whether I look at my relationships and conversations with Manoj Vaidya, with Nandan Bal, whether I look at my conversations with my own father, or with the sports medicine knowledge. The coaches are the ones who have really instilled in me professionalism and an ability to be a champion. So I'm very grateful for them.
Absolutely. I totally agree with you, Leander. I've had a chance to chat with David Womera in the early years when you were playing the circuit. You also played some Indian tournaments and, you know, you were traveling with the team. And, at those days, the other players in bat were kind of performing much better than what you were, when you were very, very young. And but even then, David Womera always said, the one person who had it in him is Leander. You know, even though the others were performing so much better than you. So what is that he saw in you to make this statement?
I think you're going to have to ask him that, Suresh, because you're being very kind. I was the worst player in that when I joined. I was the youngest boy there. Yeah. I joined on the 12th of May, 1986. Mm-hmm. And there was Rohit Rajpal, who's my Davis Cup captain now, who was senior than me. There was Asif Ismail, senior than me. Gaurav Natekar, senior than me. Rafi Farooqi, Sridhar Babalia. I can go through the whole list. But all these boys had already played tennis for about 5-6 years before they joined the academy. They were already the best in the country. Okay. For me, I hadn't even really played one tournament of national level. I had come to Bombay as a 9-year-old kid when I was the mascot of the Indian hockey team, because my father was playing for the Indian hockey team and they were playing the Aga Khan Championships in Colaba. And at 9, I used to read the newspapers and I heard that there was a Bandra Gym tournament, there was a Khar Gym tournament. So I pestered my father as to how I could play these tournaments. And he said, but you don't even know how to play tennis. He said, you know what I want to play? And as a 9-year-old, I pestered him. He taught me, Suresh, on how to take the train from BP station in Bombay all the way to Bandra station. And when you get out of the Bandra station, you walk straight down Turner Road and Bandra Gymkhana is on your left-hand side.
Wow.
So every morning, my father used to give me 100 rupees. Okay. The first day, he took me with him and he showed me how to buy my ticket at BP station. He put me on the train with him. I remember we got a vada pav in the morning. Just at BP station, and he got on the train, came all the way to Bandra station. He showed me the directions to Bandra Gymkhana, and I started playing. The first day I won, the second day I won, and on the Saturday night, he woke me up, and he said, Lee, how are you doing in your matches? I said, I'm doing well. He said, have you lost yet? I said, no, I've been winning. So he said, you must be in the finals. I said, I'm not so sure, because I'm just starting to learn how to count the score in tennis. I was 9 years old. And I said, how are your matches going? He goes, India's in the final in the Aga Khan. You're playing against Pakistan on Sunday evening. But I will come with you for the matches. And when he came on Sunday morning to Bandra Gymkhana, that is when I saw all the trophies lined up. And that was the one most motivational factor that I have, is trophies. That's exactly what I play for. And I remember I beat Sandeep Kirtane in the final. And it was a tough match because Sandeep was so technically sound. His backhand down the line pass was excellent. Yeah. And I remember that even then, the Bandra Gymkhana courts were so fast. My main aim was never to let the ball bounce, to take everything in the air. And I remember winning that first tournament at the age of 9, and that's what got me hooked.
Now, Lee, talking about your days at the bat, coming forward, you won the Junior Wimbledon. Then you have 18 Grand Slams. Then a bronze medal at the Olympics, Asian Games, gold medal, Commonwealth gold medal. You have got the most number of wins in the doubles in the Davis Cup. You know, someone, when you talk about bad days, you had Asif, you had Sandeep, you had Rohit Reddy. You know, these guys have already hung their boots. What is the one thing which keeps you going at this age, Leander? You're still there, Manoj, on the circuit for so many years.
Manoj, you've known me a long time. And for me, the relationships that I've had through tennis are the things that I cherish the most. When I look at your smile and I look at what we're doing today, for most of y'all that don't know, that Manoj's daughter is actually helping me with my business away from tennis. She helps me with the digital world because I'm not so savvy with tech. And she's helping me do that. Those relationships over generations are what's special. When I first started playing tennis, and R.K. Khanna was the president of AITA. I wouldn't be who I am today without Mr. Khanna, because he actually helped me in the juniors. As a 14-year-old and a 15-year-old, he helped me get onto the ITF junior team. Because at that point, my family could not afford for all the international coaching, the international
travel. Right. Mm-hmm.
And then after that, now Anil Khanna was the president. Now we look at Vishwadeep. How many Davis Cup matches over the last two decades that I've played, that Vishwadeep has been there comparing, interviewing us, being on the center court with me, working with me in my office. So it's the relationships that I share. I look at Suresh. Suresh and me go back a long, long time in terms of a passion for tennis. You know, his WhatsApp slogan is keep the fire burning. You know, these are things that we believe in. You know, my relationships in tennis, Manoj, are really what's important. I go right around the world. Today, on a phone call, I could have Novak Djokovic to ask him some advice about his racket equipment. I could have Tsitsipas, who I was help coaching during the Washington, D.C. tournament in 2019 and the U.S. Open. I have him and his father on a phone call. Some of my dearest friends are Navratilova and Hingis, both the Martinas of the world. So these relationships around the world are really special for me, and that's what keeps me going.
Okay. Now, this is one question which I think most of the juniors and obviously the coaches would like to ask you. The transition from a junior player to a men's player. You know, can you send us or tell us a pathway, how do you do it? You've been a junior Wimbledon champ, and then again, you have done tremendously well in the doubles and the singles world.
I think that is the real magic question of Indian tennis. We look at so many juniors out there who are fantastic talent. If I go around the country and I look at the talent we have in the under 16 boys event, under 16 girls event, that when we look at the under 18s ITF, a lot of us have done well. Ramesh Krishnan has won Junior Wimbledon. I have won Junior Wimbledon. You look at Tanya Mirza, she's won the doubles there. You look at young Sumit Nagal, he's done well at the doubles at Wimbledon. But then as you go into the seniors, I feel that tennis as a fraternity, the motivation to keep the juniors playing the game is something that can get better. I feel that when we look at having more incentives in terms of job incentives, in terms of earning money, in terms of what you are doing today is so wonderful, to unite the whole community of tennis. I think this is what is special, to show that even if not everybody can be a Roger Federer, not everybody can be a Serena Williams, not everybody could be a Leander or a Sanya, I feel that to create jobs like this where the coaches can earn a living, where the coaches come in as a community and they can make a difference, that they feel proud of the hard work they're putting in. I think what you all are doing here is very special. I think this is something we need to expand on. This is something we need to grow on so that all the juniors who from the age of 17, 18 are thinking, can I earn a living with playing professional tennis? Or am I that good that I can turn pro? That instead of all of them going into colleges, I would say about 80 to 90% of our really good juniors are all going to American colleges. When I travel to a Stanford, I see them there. When I travel to a New York, I see them in Columbia University. When I travel to a Virginia, I see them on practicing there. So there are so many young kids who are taking their tennis talent to get themselves scholarships to go abroad and study. I think this is a very important part in terms of the young kids joining our game. Also, to expand, Manoj, on your question, I see that a lot of youngsters are rather going into football, rather going into cricket, rather going into shooting or badminton. Sports that are at least a little easier to pick up than tennis, because tennis is a tough game to pick up. The coordination skills, the technique, the size of the athletes internationally deter our young kids. They generally going into cricket and other sports that are showing them greater benefits. I feel that tennis is such a global sport, which is one. Plus with tennis, you can actually get yourself a scholarship where your education is paid for. So at the age of 17, 18, you can go out and you don't have to rely on sponsorship money to go into college. You don't have to rely on your parents being able to pay $500,000 to go take you to college. I feel that tennis is such a beautiful sport that it gives such great opportunity.
Okay, now one big question. How much does mental training help you?
I think that the mental side of the game is about, I was going to say 80% of performance, but I'll keep it gentle. I'll say the mental side, the mental fitness is about 75% of the game of tennis. I think it all starts here, because if you're mentally fit, then you can be physically fit. If you're mentally astute, you can pick up what your coaches are saying. I think the two big things that we really need to focus on is emotional fitness and mental fitness. The other stuff can be taught. The technique of running, the technique of agility, the technique of forehands and backhands and kick serves and slice serves, those can be taught. But really focus on the emotional fitness and the mental fitness.
Okay, now talking about juniors, you think at the age of 14, 16, the parents are, you go around watching most of the, you're there in most of the academies, you're there, you're going around the world also. But do you think parents and coaches are putting too much pressure at your junior level?
Pressure is something that is always around you. I think how you deal with pressure is really important. I think that is where the teacher and Chandrasekhar made it such a big difference in my life. That is where a bat academy made such a difference in my life. That is where when I have conversations, Manoj, with yourself, or when I have conversations with my father or my mother, or when I come into Davis Cup, I focus in and I separate myself from all the pressure. I think pressure is always around you. I grew up to two parents who were real rock stars in their field. If I had to feel the pressure of emulating my mom, who was the captain of India, where I used to iron her number 5 basketball national playing jersey as an 8-9-year-old, the pressure was there. If I had to emulate my father and feel the pressure of, am I ever going to play the Olympics? Am I ever going to get an Olympic medal? I don't think India would have ever got that Olympic medal in tennis because of the fact that I would have felt the pressure. I would have succumbed to it. So I think the coaches did a great job with me where they looked at mental fitness and emotional fitness as a project. It wasn't something that they actually worked at it every day. There is a system. I myself have been working for the last 25 years with my father and my mother and the coaches around the world and the Olympic institutes around the world, like in Colorado with the US Football Institute or the Australian Institute of Sport, to compile this knowledge. And as I slow down with tennis and I'm finishing tennis, I'm looking to actually take that into schools, take that with AIT and shares, take that with academies around the country to focus on the mental aspects of life and the game, the emotional aspects of life and the game, because the technique and physicality, you can always teach.
Okay. Now, coming to losses, you know, it happens so many times for a player. You keep losing. So, how do you cope up with losses?
I just don't remember them. I think if you look at most athletes in the world, every one of us have lost more matches than we've won.
Exactly. Yeah.
Cardinal rule. For me, I know that my win-loss record is about at 60% loss and about 40% win on an average. But what the real focus on is on peaking when it matters. When you focus in a whole 52-week calendar, in a one-year calendar, physiologically and biomechanically, you can peak about four times a year maximum. For us in tennis, we're lucky that we have four Grand Slams a year. Yeah. So I've always focused on trying to peak at those Grand Slams. Peaking at the Australian Open is not so much a worry. Peaking at the US Open is not so much a worry because they're so set apart. But where there's a real fitness issue and a mental, emotional fatigue issue is between the French Open and Wimbledon. That recovery time, because one moving from clay courts to grass courts in a matter of 2 weeks is not really easy. At the same time, if you do well at the French Open, where I've done really well at the French Open over the years, to then recover physically and emotionally to Wimbledon is very tough. I'm a bit lucky that the grass court tennis, playing on the grass at Wimbledon, comes very naturally to me because I grew up at the South Club. So that my game, my serve and volley game, my little chip and charge game, my volleying game, comes kind of naturally to me. So that's something that I've been very lucky with.
Okay. Now talking about you started as a junior Wimbledon champion in singles, right? You performed very good in the singles. And then when was the time? What age you thought that okay, now singles is too much for me. I should now concentrate on doubles. I think most of the Indian players are also good in doubles. So what do you think? How do you switch from singles to doubles?
That's the one regret I have, Manoj, if there's any regret in my career, is that I gave up the singles in the year of 1999. For me, in 1998, I had already worked for about 15 years to get up into the top 100. And having beaten Sampras at New Haven in the Pilot Pen Open, having done well in challengers, I think I'd won like 12 or 13 challengers leading up into 1998. And then winning the Newport Hall of Fame single, I got up to the highest ranking of 73, which meant that was the first year I was getting direct entry into all the Grand Slams. It was the first year I was getting direct entry into all the 250s, all the 500s. I was just on the threshold of making it into the Master Series, as they called it then. You know, now they call it the ATP Thousands. So I felt that in 98, in the winter of 98, I had to make a calculated decision where the tennis, the court, the playing surfaces were slowing down. The tennis balls were slowing down. They were going more to putting in 20 tons of sand into the paint. So the surfaces were getting more gritty. So the serve and volleyers were being pushed out of the game. It was more playing from the baseline. The tennis balls were getting bigger and fluffier. Before, we used to use really small balls that would fly through the air, like they use at the French Open now. But the game was slowing down. So I felt that as a serve and volleyer, I had to decide whether to continue with only singles or to switch to doubles, because it was getting very tough to do both. And if I had known, Manoj, at that time that I was going to have such a long career playing up till, you know, I'm about a month shy of my 47th birthday, I would have probably continued my singles for at least another 4 or 5 years and tried to push the boundary that now I'd gotten to the top 75 in the world. Could I get into the top 50 in the world? I felt it was fairly comfortable to get from 73 to the top 50. And then to try and push to get into the top 40 in the world or the top 25 in the world. To me, I think that I did myself short in my singles career because I was also number two in the world in doubles in 98. We had just gotten to all the four Grand Slam semifinals. And then I felt that it was more important to prove to India that we could be Grand Slam champions. Because until 1999, we had not won a Grand Slam yet. And I felt that giving up my singles at that point, not sure how long my career would have been, and going to the doubles, in 99, look what a year Mahesh and myself had. We won two Grand Slams at the French and Wimbledon. We were very unlucky not to win the Australian Open. We lost in five sets to Bjorken and Rafter. And then we got the finals of the US. So it was a great year for tennis, getting to four Grand Slam finals. But I felt I did myself short with singles.
Yeah. Now, just coming into this, you think the Indian build, Indian, I'm talking about Indian players build is more for doubles. We can't withstand the singles. And normally we see the Indian singles player, we start performing at the age of 21, 22 onwards. We don't have that much, that many years of play. So what do you think about that?
One is, I agree with you that the Indian body and the Indian mind matures a bit later. I think that the patience is really of the essence. The hard work is of the essence. I think Indians, as general, we are very intelligent. We are very mentally and intelligent about absorbing and being really good students. I think that where we lack is one of the areas where my strengths are, which is the mental fitness, the emotional fitness, and the physical fitness. Yes, I was born to great sports genetics. Yes, I inherited my DNA in terms of my muscle size or in terms of my running ability, my quick twitch fibers. I inherited those. But the hard work, like Suresh brought up, the hard work that I had to do in that, waking up at 4:30 every morning, 6 days a week, putting in those 10-hour days, 12-hour days, practicing from 5 in the morning to 8 in the morning, learning technique, where all the boys would beat me that time when I was 12 years old. All of them would beat me on our Saturday or weekend matches. My first 2 years, Manoj, I did not win a game. I would lose to Rohit Rajpal, love six. Uh-huh. I would lose to Rafi Farooqi, Rafi was so talented, but he would not put in the same hours I would put, but he was just so much better. I would lose to him, love 6-1-6. I would get hammered by these guys every day. I mean, literally, every night that I went home, my whole 1986 year, from the 12th of May 1986 to the 12th of May 1987, I cried every single night. Because tennis was just so hard for me. We would run 4 days a week. We would run 7 kilometers on the Marina Beach sand to build the power and the strength of the legs, to build the lungs. After we'd finish practice from 5 in the morning to 8 in the morning, we'd go to school from 9 in the morning to 3:30 in the afternoon with a 45-minute break for lunch from 12:30 to 1:15. You finish at 3:30 in the afternoon, our school bag would be packed. It would come to the school where the tennis courts were. We change for half an hour, and 4 o'clock, we're back on the courts again. Practice from 4 o'clock to 7:30. That time we would actually do drills. We do point drills. We do serving volley drills. We do return and second shot drills. 7:30, you finish, you go back home. You have 1 hour for dinner. 7:30 to 8:30 dinner, sit on tuition work from 9 at night to 10:30 at night. And back then there were no smartphones or electronics where we could keep in touch. Some of the boys would sit down and write letters. And when they'd fall asleep at 11 o'clock, I used to put out candles in front of my mirror, turn the lights off so the wardens wouldn't know that I'm awake. And in front of my full-length mirror and candles around with my tennis shoes and shorts on bare-chested, I would do shadow practice for 1 hour. I do 10,000 sit-ups. I do 10,000 skips. So then I could make up over those 5 years at bat. I could not only make up to these 8 kids who would hammer me every Saturday, to then become number one in the world in the juniors, only because of the hard work.
Manoj, I'll just interject once. First of all, I mean, amazing conversation that you've had just now. You know, this is what tells everybody what it takes to become a Leander Paes. It's not a cakewalk. It's one hell of a lot of grit and perspiration. But I just wanted to quickly request Narsingh to also come online because we want one or two questions, I think, in Hindi. And one personal question that I have, Leander, which is to do with your amazing skill at the net. So, I mean, we'll move a little bit. I really want to move a little bit from the mental to the actual, actual skill that you have on being such a brilliant player on the net and what goes behind that. How do you make sure that you continue to be such a brilliant with such fantastic reflexes and hand-eye coordination and everything. Maybe you could give us a little bit of an insight into that. Sorry about this, Suresh, but I really wanted to talk about this.
This is one thing that I really got to thank my parents for, because the foresight that my father had was that when I was about 3-4 years old, he recognized a physical talent that I had. And as I grew a little older, he would teach me these physical drills. So I believe when I was in the crib, I don't remember, but I believe when I was in the crib, my father used to put these colored balls on top of the crib of all different sizes, all different shapes. And he would get me to touch them with my hand like this and just move them. And then he would put different sized balls between my legs when I was in the crib. So I would get to play with them with my legs. Already doing a brain mapping of my brain and eye-hand coordination. My brain and eye-feet coordination. Also, I remember when I was about 8, 9, 10, 11 years old, I thought he was the coolest dad in the world because he used to give me 100 rupees a day to play video games. And it's a bit of misspent youth. But every single day, I had to spend 100 rupees at the Sub-Zero video game parlor on Park Street, right opposite my house. And I thought this was so cool. Until I realized the trick that he was doing by playing video games. Back then, there was Pac-Man, was the most important, like the most popular game. Space Invaders was a popular game. And by working that joystick with my right hand and watching the screen go around, that was the first kind of digital technology that had come around. Nowadays, you have some very sophisticated digital technology to train your eyes because the eye training is one of the most important things in sport today. When you see something, then only can your brain click in. And then when your brain clicks in, then the rest of your muscle memory comes and your body reacts. But I feel that playing those video games, even today using digital computers to touch and feel and work things is the reason that my eye hands are so fast. Also, contrary to much belief that most people think you volley with your hands are for spin, your hands are for touch, but actually you volley with your legs. I feel tennis as a sport is one of the toughest sports in the world because it is the most important aspect of tennis is agility and balance. And I look at a Novak Djokovic, the reason that he's so formidable today, the reason that Federer had such a long career, the reason Nadal is so good on clay, is that a sense of balance to create stability, being in the perfect position every time, to create the torque and the rotation, and then the power, is something they have learned over so many years. So for me, I volley with my legs to make sure my legs are in position every single time. So even at 47, today the skipping that I do about, I would say a good 5,000 skips every single day. We used to skip with a heavy rope, but now we do speed rope. But to keep my legs quick, to keep my body always in position and the balance good, is the reason I volley pretty well.
Just the last question from me, Leander. Any fitness tip during the lockdown?
Yes, there's so much to do. I think this lockdown is a great opportunity for all of us. One, to spend quality time with our family. Two, to pick up hobbies and pick up things that we haven't had the time to before. I think fairly soon, this lockdown is going to lift over the next couple of months. And then we're going to go back to normal work, which is chasing the history books like I try and do, to chase winning tournaments, to chase building the next Leander out there for the coaches, to chase doing all these things that we do in our normal life. But during the lockdown, it's very, very important to focus on learning new skills. For me, what I do, Manoj, is that I do my core exercises here in the house. I do my back exercises. I do my free weights exercises here in the house. I have rubber bands here. I use those to innovate new things. What I have done is this lockdown is to work on the rotation of my shoulder so that even at 47, I can actually keep the flexibility for my serve. So I do a lot of stuff with the rubber bands to do that. I keep up my skipping. I keep up my core exercises. I volley against the wall to keep that sharp. I found ways to hit serves and smashes up against the wall, so I can do that. But it's really cool to actually practice new things and learn new tricks. I think that every situation creates an opportunity. So to keep our body fresh, to keep our mind fresh, emotionally to stay fresh is really important. So this lockdown is going to open up fairly soon.
Thanks, Leander. I think we had a lot of insight about what we are supposed to do. And we got a lot of new things to know about you. Thank you, Leander, and over to Anand.
Manoj, thank you so much for looking after me, looking after my father through all those years. You've traveled into rural Maharashtra and made so much difference with all the youngsters. Looking at all four of you all on the screen right here, there's a lot of gratitude where over the years you all have made such a difference in my career. So I'm going to touch on the other three, but Manoj, to you, thank you so much for looking after my father.
Thanks. And please pass on my regards to your dad. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, Leander.
Narsingh sir, good morning. You're on mute. You have to unmute, sir. So, tumhe aapko sunai dete.
Narsingh, you have to unmute yourself. Yeah.
One more press. Unmute yourself, sir.
No, it's okay.
Ah, shabash. Ah. I recognize that voice. Kaise ho saab sir?
Bas theek hai Leander. Aap sunao kaise hain?
मैं एकदम बढ़िया हूँ सर, मगर आज सुबह आप सबको बताने का है कि डेविस कप का कोर्ट तक तैयारी कैसे करते थे सर।
मैं वही बात करने वाला था, क्योंकि अभी तक जो बातें हुई है सारी आपकी और मनोज और सुरेश और विश्वदीप की, कि वो टेनिस के बारे में बहुत कुछ हुई है। अगर मैं बात करूं कि आज हम लोग कहते हैं आर्मी के अंदर में मेजर कर्नल जनरल्स एंड द चीफ ऑफ आर्मी, तो मैं कहूंगा टेनिस के अंदर चीफ ऑफ Our tennis is Leander, क्योंकि इसमें औहदे नहीं मिलते, इसमें आपको काफी ऊपर तक जो पहुंचे हैं आप, वो एक बहुत बड़ी उपलब्धि है आपके लिए और हमारे देश के लिए भी। साथ ही जैसे आपने कहा कि हम लोग काफी चर्चा करते थे मैच से पहले और मैच के बाद भी, तो उस बारे में जरूर बात करूंगा मैं। लेकिन उससे पहले कि मैं आपके टेनिस के बारे में जरूर बात करूंगा, जब आप अंडर 12 अंडर 14 जब दिल्ली खेलने आते थे, उस टाइम पर सून आफ्टर द मैच यू कम्स टू मी, क्योंकि उस टाइम आपको बोला जाता कि लोकल वहां पर आपको कुछ भी सपोर्ट चाहिए तो नर्सिंग इज देयर, सो यू टू कम। आई कैन नॉट फॉरगेट दैट डे, कि जिस दिन आपने आपको एक हवा चल रही थी और आप टॉस के ऊपर थोड़ा गड़बड़ हो रहा था आपका, देन यू केम आफ्टर द मैच एंड आस्क मी सर क्या हुआ है मेरे मैच में, क्या कर रहा था मैं, मेरा तरह टॉस थोड़ा गड़बड़ था, एंड यू सेड सर क्या करना चाहिए, मैंने कहा थोड़ा टॉस को ऐसे करना है। आई स्टिल रिमेंबर यू वेंट टू द क्ले कोर्ट्स और वो करना शुरू किया था, मैंने कहा था 10 मिनट बाद मैं आ रहा हूँ कोर्ट पे देखने क्या कर रहे हो, बट इट वॉज कंटिन्यूइंग टिल द 45 और 50 मिनट्स, आप वो धुन में लगे रहे अपनी कि सर ने बोला है तो मैं करता रहूंगा। तो वो चीज जो आपके अंदर लगन थी, अभी आप कह रहे थे कि सो रहा था और जूत अपने शूज को अपने चेस्ट के ऊपर रखता था मैं, और वो जो आपके अंदर जुनून था वो आज दिखता है कि वो जुनून जो था आपको कहाँ पर लिखे गया, इसके बारे में थोड़ा बताएं आप।
सर आपका पहला मुलाकात मैं समर ऑफ 1987 हुए थे, आप चेन्नई आए थे रोहित राजपाल के साथ और रोहित के कमरे में हम लोग बैठ के बात कर रहे थे, और तब से जो नरसिंह सर बोलते हैं मैं बहुत ध्यान से सुनता हूँ, क्योंकि नरसिंह सर का जो नॉलेज है डेविस कप का, जो कोर्ट का तैयारी करने के लिए, ग्रास कोर्ट का तैयारी करने के लिए, बॉल टॉस का प्रिपरेशन करने के लिए, वो जो नॉलेज आपने मेरे को दिए हैं तब से मेरे को याद है। एंड ऑल दैट टेक्निक इन 1987 इन रोहित्स रूम, यू वर टॉकिंग टू हिम अबाउट हाउ ही कुड प्लान हिज होल डे टू बी अ प्रोफेशनल एथलीट, नॉट फोकस ऑन हिटिंग बॉल्स ओनली 6 hours अ डे, बट ऑल्सो फोकस ऑन हिज फिजिकल फिटनेस, ऑल्सो फोकस ऑन हिज मेंटल कामनेस। टूडे रोहित राजपाल वो हमारा डेविस कप का कैप्टन है, और मैं इतना खुश हूँ कि हमारा रूममेट अभी हमारा कैप्टन, और मैं इतना खुश हूं कि हमारा इतना जिगरी दोस्त हमारे साथ डेविस कप का बेंच पे बैठते हैं। मगर 1987 से नर्सिंग सर जो कुछ आपने मेरे को सिखाए अब तक याद है, जैसा रैकेट का ग्रिपिंग कैसा करने के लिए, मैं टोना ग्रिप यूज करते थे तब, क्योंकि चेन्नई में इतना धूप थे, इतना गर्मी थे, इतना ह्यूमिडिटी थे, तो मैं काफी स्वेट करता हूँ, तो आपने मेरे को सिखाए कि वो जो सॉडस्ट जो है, सॉडस्ट भी डेविस कप, हर डेविस कप के मैच पे हमारे बेंच के सामने आपने एक सॉडस्ट का डब्बा रखते थे।
तो ये चीजें लियांडर, ये सब चीजें ही हैं मैं अभी बात करने वाला था, क्योंकि मनोज ने और सुरेश ने काफी टेनिस के बारे में बात करी, जो इनसाइड स्टोरीज होती हैं बिफोर द मैच या आफ्टर द मैच, जो आपकी प्रिपरेशन होती है, वही इसी बारे में बात करना चाहता था मैं, कि आपकी प्रिपरेशन जो होती थी एक एक चीज की बहुत बारीकियों से आप देखते थे, और उस प्रिपरेशन को आप कभी नहीं भूलते थे। जैसा कि आपने 1987 चेन्नई वाली बात भी करी है, तो वो मैं भी शायद थोड़ा सा धुंधला हो गया था, लेकिन आज आपने वो याद दिलाई तो पूरी बातें याद आ गई, कि वो चीजें जो आप हम बात करते थे, आपको याद होगा कि थोड़े दिन पहले जब आप दिल्ली आए थे हम टेनिस की ग्रिप के बारे में बात कर रहे थे, तो आपने कहा था मेरी एक इंजरी हुई थी सर, आपको देखो जरा इन शो द ऑल द वीडियोज ऑफ दैट कैसे इंजरी थी, इस पर थोड़ा प्रकाश डालें, क्योंकि ये चीज बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है कि आपको कैसे अपने आप को सेफ रखना है और कैसे आगे आगे बढ़ना है, कि इंजरी ना हो, जो आपको इंजरी हुई थी उसके बारे में थोड़ा बताएं जरूर आप।
करेक्ट, स्टेइंग इंजरी फ्री सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट चीज है, क्योंकि टेनिस इतना टफ स्पोर्ट है कि टेनिस का जो टेक्निक है काफी एबनॉर्मल है बायोमैकेनिक्स के लिए। जैसा किक सर्व मारते हैं, जैसा शोल्डर का रोटेशन होता है, ये रोटेटर कफ को एकदम हेल्थी रखना चाहिए। जैसा बैकहैंड मारते हैं शोल्डर के ऊपर, काफी टेक्निकल स्पोर्ट है। जो बदन का रोटेशन जो होता है, बदन का जो बैलेंस जो होते हैं, और टू क्रिएट दैट रोटेशन एंड बैलेंस एंड देन क्रिएट पावर फ्रॉम देयर। और जर्मन खिलाड़ी, अमेरिकन खिलाड़ी, यूरोपियन खिलाड़ी, रशियन खिलाड़ी इतना ताकत से बॉल मारते हैं कि इंडियन खिलाड़ी का जो ताकत जो होता है ना, यू हैव टू कॉन्सेंट्रेट ऑन द पावर। इंडियन खिलाड़ी का काफी टच होता है, इंडियन खिलाड़ी का काफी मेंटल स्ट्रेटजीज बहुत बढ़िया होते हैं, मगर ये जो पावर चीज जो है ना टेनिस में जो आए करीब 1990s में, और इस बेकर लाए थे पावर, आंद्रे एगसी ग्राउंड स्ट्रोक का पावर लाए थे, उसका फोरहैंड बैकहैंड कितना तेज मारते हैं। तो ये जो पावर गेम जो है ना, आई थिंक दिस इज द वन रीजन दैट वी आर मिसिंग आउट ऑन सिंगल्स इन इंडिया। आई थिंक दैट व्हेन यू लुक एट रजनीश सर, वर्ल्ड क्लास सर, व्हेन यू लुक एट सोमदेव फुटवर्क, वर्ल्ड क्लास फुटवर्क, व्हेन यू लुक एट रामकुमार सर्व एंड फोरहैंड, सो पावरफुल, वर्ल्ड क्लास। बट देन व्हेन यू लुक एट द टोटैलिटी ऑफ इट, द मेंटल एप्टीट्यूड, द इमोशनल एप्टीट्यूड, जिस तरह से आपने मेरे को सिखाया कि डेविस कप के मैच पे मैं काफी इमोशनल है आपके ऊपर, क्योंकि हर डेविस कप मैच जो मैं दिल्ली में खेलते, हर डेविस कप मैच जो मैं इंडिया में खेलते, आप है वहां पे और आप एक मिनट के लिए कोर्ट भी छोड़ा ही नहीं। मेरे को पता है कि लेफ्ट साइड पे कोने पे नरसिंह सर बैठा होगा, तो काश मैच टफ है। जब मैं कोरिया को हराए थे फिफ्थ मैच में, फिफ्थ रबर में, मैं रमेश कृष्णन सुबह एक सिंगल्स हारे थे, सो इट बिकेम टू ऑल। और फिफ्थ मैच में 1991 के बाद बोल रहे सर, मई 1991, और तब फिफ्थ मैच में वन सेट ऑल थे, और तीसरा सेट में जब मैं थोड़ा सा मेंटली थोड़ा सा डाउट हमारे हमारे माइंड में थे, मैं साइड पे देखा नरसिंह सर बैठे थे, वहां नरेश कुमार बेंच पे बैठे थे, और तब मेरे को कॉन्फिडेंस आया कि थोड़ा सा जुगाड़ करने के, थोड़ा सा चिप इन चार्ज करने के, थोड़ा सा ड्रॉप शॉट नेट पे चार्ज करने का। तो ये जो हमारा टेनिस टेक्निक शायद परफेक्ट नहीं है, शायद मेरा बैकहैंड परफेक्ट नहीं, शायद मेरा रिटर्न ऑफ सर्व इतना अच्छा नहीं, मगर मेरा जो कॉन्फिडेंस है, मेरे में जो कॉन्फिडेंस है, और मेरा कोचेज जो जिस तरह से मेरे को सिखाए हैं कि मेरा फिजिकल एट्रीब्यूट, मेरा मेंटल एट्रीब्यूट, मेरा इमोशनल एट्रीब्यूट को लेके मैं इससे लड़ेंगे, मैं ओपोनेंट्स को मेंटल फिटनेस से हराएंगे, फिजिकल फिटनेस से हराएंगे। तो ये जो तरीका जो है, काफी तरीका है मैच जीतने के लिए, खाली फोरहैंड्स एंड बैकहैंड्स का तरीका नहीं, खाली सर्व एंड वॉली या बिग सर्व का तरीका नहीं है जीतने के लिए, काफी तरीका है जीतने के लिए। और ये जब हम लोग बैठते थे और बात करते हैं कि किस तरह से हम हर ओपोनेंट को जुगाड़ यूज करके, फिटनेस यूज करके, मेंटल एप्टीट्यूड यूज करके जिस तरह से वो अपोनेंट्स को हराने का है, ये मेरा सबसे बड़े लर्निंग है हमारे कोचेस से। तो ये सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट चीज है, सी कोचेस टू आस्क द कोचेस द राइट क्वेश्चन इज द मोस्ट इम्पोर्टेंट थिंग टू अब्सॉर्ब फ्रॉम द कोचेस। हर जूनियर्स जो है, मैं उसको सिखाता हूँ कि जब आप मनोज सर के साथ बैठते हैं, जब आप सुरेश के साथ बैठते हैं, जब आप कोचेस के साथ बैठते हैं, ask them the right questions. No question is silly. Ask the right questions and really pay attention to what they say. Because the, out of 10 things that your coaches tell you, if every day, har din, ek cheez seekhenge na sir, pure saal mein 365 cheez seekh sakte. Har din, ek cheez seekha. Don't try and be perfect at everything, but every day, learn one thing. And at the end of 3 months, you will be 90 things richer. At the end of 1 year, you will be 365 ideas richer than you are when you started in January 1st.
बहुत बड़ी बात की लियंडर आपने इस बारे में, और मैं फिर वो एक बार बात करना चाहता हूँ आपसे कि इस बारे में कि आपके साथ खाली आपने कहा कि फोरहैंड बैकहैंड मारना ही काफी नहीं है और बहुत सारी चीज सीखना जरूरी है। As we remember those days की जब हम अब आप जूनियर थे तब से लेकर अब तक, अब जब डेविस कप भी खेलते रहे, हम अक्सर बात बहुत सारी करते हैं, आप जैसे आते ही पहले दिन मेरे से बात करते थे कि सर कोर्ट की पोजीशन क्या है, बॉल कौन सी है, किस तरह की बॉल है, किस तरह की मेरा रैकेट है, मेरा रैकेट देखे जरा, मेरी स्ट्रिंग देखे आप सर, संजय यूज़ टू बी हेल्प यू इन द स्ट्रिंगिंग द रैकेट ऑफ योर्स, यू नो दोस थिंग्स मेक्स अ बिग डिफरेंस यू विनिंग योर मैचेस। तो आपने वो इस बारे में थोड़ा सा और मेरे को बताएं, फिर उसके बाद मैं एक और लास्ट क्वेश्चन करूंगा मैं, कि आपकी जो इक्विपमेंट की प्रिपरेशन होती थी या सरफेस की प्रिपरेशन होती थी वो आप बहुत ही माइंड बारीकी से देखते थे और उसको कभी भी निगलेक्ट नहीं करते थे, इवन अपने जितने भी को प्लेयर होते थे आपके, या आई स्टिल रिमेम्बर द प्रकाश अमृतराज जब पहला मैच अपना जयपुर में खेल रहे थे, आपने मेरे पास बैठा के आधा घंटा उसको लेक्चर दिलवाया था कि सर इसको समझाओ कुछ इसको बताए थोड़ा उसके बारे में भी।
सर हर कोई खेल सकते हैं, हर कोई फोरहैंड बैकहैंड मार सकते हैं, हर कोई का सर्व या रिटर्न अच्छा है, मगर द डिफरेंस बिटवीन बीइंग गुड एंड बीइंग ग्रेट इज इन द डिटेल्स, आई कॉल देम 1%। पिताजी ने जो सिखाया हमारे को कि हर जगह पे 1% और अच्छा बढ़ सकते हैं, 1% यहाँ पे फिटनेस पे और बढ़ सकते हैं, 1% अपना डाइट पे और बढ़ सकते हैं, 1% अपना जो इक्विपमेंट जो है वो और अच्छा बन सकते हैं। तो इफ यू एड अप द 1% इट बिकम्स 10% सर, और 10% बहुत बड़ी बात है। समटाइम्स यू विन अ मैच ओनली इन वन शॉट, समटाइम्स यू विन अ मैच जस्ट बाय लुकिंग योर एट योर ओपोनेंट इन द आई व्हेन यू आर क्रॉसिंग द नेट, समटाइम्स व्हेन यू आर इवन नर्वस जस्ट टू कॉन्सेंट्रेट ऑन योर ब्रेथ टू कीप योरसेल्फ काम टू कीप योर पल्स रेट लो, यू कैन विन मैच ऑन जस्ट स्टेइंग काम। सो आई फील दैट ये जो इक्विपमेंट जो होते हैं टेनिस में ये बहुत बड़ी चीज होते हैं। मेरा बहुत पसीना चुभता है, आई स्वेट अ लॉट, तो ऑन माय रैकेट्स टू लर्न हाउ टू ग्रिप द रैकेट, वो बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट चीज है, क्योंकि हर 15 मिनट हर 20 मिनट मेरे को नया ग्रिप यूज करता है, और जैसा मैं एक जगह पहुंचते हैं जैसा मैं एयरपोर्ट पे ही लैंड करता हूँ, मैं ड्राइवर को ही पूछता हूँ या जैसा जिसको पहला मिलते हैं उसको पूछता हूँ कि यहाँ का मौसम कैसा है, अभी लास्ट 2 वीक का मौसम कैसा चल रहा है, बारिश चल रहे, गर्मी चल रहे, हवा में चल रहे, या ह्यूमिडिटी है कि नहीं, क्योंकि ह्यूमिडिटी डिटर्मिन्स द टेंशन ऑफ द रैकेट, द वेदर डिटर्मिन्स द टेंशन ऑफ द स्ट्रिंग, बिकॉज इवन इफ यू चेंज द प्री स्ट्रेच बाय 5% इंस्टेड ऑफ हैविंग 10% प्री स्ट्रेच यू मेक इट 15% प्री स्ट्रेच, द स्ट्रिंग द टेंशन रिमेन्स फॉर अ लॉन्गर पीरियड ऑफ टाइम। तो जब मैं विंबलडन पे खेलता हूँ नरसिंह सर, मैं अपना प्री स्ट्रेच 5% बढ़ाता हूँ, क्योंकि इंग्लैंड में विंबलडन के समय मौसम हर दिन बदलते हैं, सुबह से लेकर शाम तक मौसम बदलते हैं, सुबह जब मैं उठता हूँ शायद धूप है बाहर, गर्मी है बाहर, और शाम तक शायद बारिश पड़ रही है। तो आई पुट माई रैकेट्स इन अ प्लास्टिक बैग एंड आई रैप देम विद रबर बैंड, so that even the climate inside that bag remains the same, and each racket, all 10 of my rackets that I travel with are always put in my racket wrapped in its individual bag, and I think the specifics of that are important, kyunki jaisa new balls aate hain 7 and 9 games jaisa new balls aate hain, I pull out a new racket to wo tension ek hi banta hai, if a match is 3 hours long or if a match is 5 hours long best of 5 sets at Wimbledon, the tension of the racket remains the same. So equipment bahut important cheez hai, especially if you look at your game style, you have to choose the racket that you want to play with. If you are a player that plays with a lot of spin, you have to choose a racket that gives you the arc over the net, kyunki kafi aajkal khiladi western grips use karte hain. जब मैं शुरू करते थे सर, हम लोग कॉन्टिनेंटल ग्रिप यूज करते थे, हम लोग ईस्टर्न ग्रिप से कोचेस सिखाते थे, आजकल एकदम पूरा वेस्टर्न ग्रिप्स है, काश मैं इस वेस्टर्न ग्रिप से खेले शायद माय रिस्ट विल आल्सो फॉल ऑफ, आदत नहीं है, मगर आजकल जिस तरह से ये लोग मारते हैं वेस्टर्न ग्रिप से मैं नहीं कर सकता, थोड़ा सा सेमी वेस्टर्न से खेल सकता मगर पूरा वेस्टर्न से नहीं खेल सकता।
करेक्ट, आज के ग्रिप जो है बिल्कुल सही कहा आपने, कि आपने आपने काफी सही कहा कि ग्रेटनेस आपकी है कि आज अपनी गेम को आप उसी प्रकार रखते हैं, और इसी साथ मैं अपने साथी सुरेश को कहूंगा कि सुरेश वाइंड अप करने का टाइम आ गया है, क्योंकि नेक्स्ट जो लेक्चर है बड़ा इंटरेस्टिंग है वो भी। थैंक यू लियंडर सो मच एंड रिमेम्बरिंग ऑल द ओल्ड डेज, और सबको आप याद रखते हैं, सबके संग चलते हैं, यही आपकी एक बहुत ही ग्रेटनेस है। थैंक यू वेरी मच वंस अगेन लियंडर।
थैंक यू सर।
थैंक यू नसीक सर, आपको बहुत प्यार करता हूँ. इतने साल हम लोग काफी डेविस कप मैच जीत चुके हैं, कि इतने साल से काफी रिकॉर्ड जीत चुके हैं, मगर आई वुडंट हैव बीन एबल टू डू दैट विदाउट ऑल ऑफ यू. All of you all have played such a big role in my life, and very humbly, I get emotional about you guys. Just thank you.
Thank you
for all the years.
Thanks,
Suresh. Suresh, just one quick observation that I want to make. I after hearing everything that Leander said just now, I think these people who are attending this seminar, or this webinar, I think they're the, believe me, I think they're the luckiest set of people. Have actually been exposed to such completely invaluable tips from someone who is probably, undeniably actually, one of the most experienced persons in world tennis today. These are the kind of things that it takes you years and years and years to come across someone who will share these with you. Thank you so much, Leander. This was absolutely one of the most amazing interactions that we've had, and I'll hand it over to Suresh. I just can't keep, I can't thank you enough. Thank you.
It's a complete pleasure, Vishnudeep.
Thank you, Vishnudeep. Leander, we actually overshot the time by far. We have someone waiting to give a presentation on nutrition. Yeah, so before we go into that, can you tell us about the importance of nutrition in building up the physical capabilities of a tennis player?
So this has been one of the most important things I've learned from my father, is the diet and the physical aspect of the game. I think that food is the fuel to our body. So it's very important, like a Novak Djokovic is one of the most specific eaters on the tour. Novak is gluten intolerant. He cannot eat gluten. He does not digest milk products very well. So he is vegan. In India, we have a lot of vegetarians, and in that, there is nothing wrong with being vegetarian. It's actually a very, very clean way to eat, but you have to focus on the protein level that you intake, because to get the nutrients just from the food that you eat is not enough. You need to do a little bit of supplements. If you're a vegetarian, you need to eat a lot of dal, a lot of lentils, a lot of potatoes, a lot of bananas. You need to take some supplements. Nowadays, as we're traveling the world, traveling in planes, traveling on trains, going in public transport, your immune system has to be up. So doing some vitamins, vitamin C, vitamin D, vitamin like an echinacea, to keep the immune system high so that your health is remaining high. One is to stay away from infection, to stay away from any disease is very important. But with your nutrition, it's very important to test your body out. To first test your body out to know what your body does well with. Nowadays there's a big fashion for going into keto diet and going into this diet, but the kids have not tested themselves out. It's very important to test your blood, to make sure what are your iron levels, your calcium levels, your vitamin levels, your mineral levels. Test those out. And for example, I am low on calcium, I am low on iron, so I have to take those supplements. Now with tennis, with WADA, my father is not only my guru with physical fitness and diet, is also the head of World Anti-Doping. So I have to be even more careful, because all eyes have been on me for the last 30 years. So I've been a clean athlete throughout my whole life. But you've got to be very careful that every bottle of water you drink, every bottle of sports drink you drink, make sure that only your coach has handed it to you. Do not take a bottle that has been opened by someone else. Do not trust it. You never know where contamination can happen. Trust your coach, trust your team, build your team and trust those people. I think that being a champion is most important by the team that you choose around you. The team that you choose around you makes you who you are. So I think whether it's your dietitian, whether it's your fitness coach, whether it's your mental trainer, whether it's your tennis coach, whether it's your confidants, the people you keep around you. Suresh, I remember the conversations that we've had over many years, that knowledge that we've imparted back and forth, even till today. I discuss with P. Chandrasekhar the nuances of diet, or the nuances of footwork, or the nuances of my ball toss. The ball toss is something that's very important for me, because I'm only 5 feet 10 inches tall. I'm not very tall. The average height of a tennis player today is about 65, 63. At 5 feet 10, my ball toss has to be perfect. Bless you, Suresh. My ball toss has to be perfect to be able to get at the top of the toss to hit the serve. And that is where like a Narasingh sir helped me from 1987. He's been talking about how to, I remember in 1987 in the summer, sitting in Rohit Rajpal's room on his bed, he taught me that you do not hold the ball like this in your hand. You hold it in the tips of your fingers and you toss it up. It's like placing the ball on a ledge of a shelf. That was such an important trick. At 1987, he taught me, even till today, the first thing I do when I get into a windy arena, Wimbledon on centre court, the wind circles because it's a round the stadium. And the gangways that are there, the wind comes in from those gangways. I have to perfect the toss at Wimbledon because sometimes on windy days, it's very tough to serve.
It has been phenomenal listening to you. It's like you're a wealth of knowledge, and we talk to you for another 4 hours. I think you can keep coming up with some new stuff. I think you have to write a book very, very soon.
Suresh, it's been a complete pleasure talking to you and to Narasingh sir and to Vishadeep and to the whole team. To all the coaches out there, the greatest joy that you can have is to see your student mastering what you're trying to teach them. I think that the communication levels are important. I think the compassion is important. And not everybody can be a Wimbledon champion. Not everybody can be an Olympic champion. But to create a good human being, to create a human being through using tennis as a vehicle to communicate skills of life is the most important thing. And I think when we look at a country of 1.3 billion plus people, we need good people out there. And I'm so thankful to all of you. I'm so thankful to tennis. That has actually helped me travel the whole world and keep the Indian flag flying high. So thank you for this chat, Vishadeep. Thank you so much for coordinating. I'll never forget all the years that you've been at Davis Cup with me, helping me with my interviews, helping me with the courts. The second last Davis Cup, we played against Pakistan. The way you communicated with me that the venue could be in Islamabad, the venue could be in Kazakhstan, we don't know yet. But your level of communication, Vishadeep, is something that is so, so brilliant. I feel really proud to continue playing for the Indian flag, to continue playing with my blue, and to have friends like you who guide us. So thank you so much for putting this together.
Thanks a lot, Leander. Fantastic message to the coaches to finish it off on, using tennis as a vehicle to make them good human beings. Amazing advice. Thanks a lot, Leander, for being here with us. Over to the next presentation that we have for the day is by Shiny Surendran. We are sorry that we called you as Shiny Chandran, that it is her maiden name. Himanshu, can you bring Balu onto the panelist, please? Balachandran Manikat. Himanshu, can you bring Balachandran Manikat onto the panelists, please? Okay, so you also have to bring Shiny Surendran onto the screen, onto the panelists. Ah, there you are, Balu.
Morning, Suresh.
Good
morning, Vishadeep. Morning, Manoj.
And it took a bit.
Balu, how are you there?
Good.
Morning, Balu.
Morning.
That goatee is looking really trim. Even in the lockdown, you're keeping it nice and sophisticated.
A lot of time to do all this. Okay. I saw your volleys with the frying pan, not looking at the ball.
My mother still complaining. I took a non-stick frying pan and messed it up with tennis balls on it. She said she can't cook it now.
So, Balu, can you introduce Shiny Abraham and Shiny Surendran take on you. It's all you.
Yeah. Good morning and namaste to everyone. The panel and the attendees. Today's speaker is Mrs. Shiny Surendran, as you all already know. She has more than 20 years of experience in sports and preventive nutrition. After completing her master's in food science, food service management from Women's Christian College, Chennai, She further enhanced her knowledge by enrolling in many certification programs all over the world. She's the first Indian to complete graduate diploma in sports nutrition from International Olympic Committee. It's supposed to be one of the most difficult courses to complete. And has many more certifications from courses done in New Zealand and Australia. On the work front, she was a consultant at high performance gyms in Chennai, like Fitness One, Maverick, Primal Patterns, Fitness Studio. And on the sports front, she has been working with players from various sports, which include, of course, tennis, cricket, badminton, squash, swimming, kabaddi, and even wheelchair basketball. Till recently, she was a lecturer for sports nutrition in Sri Ramachandra University, Chennai. As Leander said, we learn something new every day. So, dear coaches, to educate us on how to help our players handle their nutrition and hydration better, on your behalf, I welcome Mrs. Shaini Surendra. Over to you, Shaini. You can unmute.
Thank you, Mr. Balachandran. It's such a pleasure being here. Thank you, AITA and Sports Authority of India for having invited me here to address all of you. And it is such a pleasure to hear Mr. Leander Pace speak and all you coaches out there. I think it was like taking a vitamin pill because it was years of experience which was beautifully shared, and it's such wonderful takeaways when you said emotional strength, and then you shared details about how it all started, and there's no substitute for hard work. Amazing. And Mumbai trains, the vada pav, and all the amazing hard work. So I guess that's something. Really, really glad to also meet all of your coaches here. Excellent. So I'm going to be keeping this session completely Desi Indian, because most often when we look for information, a lot of people will see Western things, and then we go looking around for berries and avocados. And during lockdown, and especially considering the fact that we are all so attached to our Desi Khana, and we need to appreciate what is available here. And I also want to highlight what Mr. Leander Pace mentioned, like, doping is a big issue. And I have met Dr. Vaes Pace. It was such an honor to meet your father. He had been to Sri Ramachandra Medical College when I used to work there as a lecturer. And I had interacted with him in the right proportions and absolutely, being extremely careful, or rather it's best not to use any supplements. So it was such a big takeaway in those years of my career to listen to him. Okay, so I'll go ahead, deep dive into the presentation. I would like to share the slides. Kindly let me know if you can see this. Yeah, okay, perfect. Okay, so I'll go ahead with this. So I'm going to really run through, because I think we are already running out of time. I've kept it to the basics. Okay, so all of us love our vehicles, the cars or bikes or whatever you have, right? Basic, easy way to understand would be, so irrespective of what car you have, whether you have a small car or if it's going to be a high-end luxury car or an SUV, you need to. I live in Chennai. Okay, so if I were to plan a trip, definitely have to ensure that my fuel tank is full, right? So when I drive there, I make sure that my fuel is full. A lot of people there, and of course also sightseeing and all of that, over a period of time the fuel is going to run out. So likewise, a tennis player, whether it's a child athlete or a seasoned player, has to ensure that the fuel tank is full. When I say fuel, it's not just the food, it's also hydration. It's very important that fluids are also maintained really well. And this has to be topped up. And there are but a few people who sweat quite a lot. So even before starting the session, 2-3 days well ahead of time, it's good that they really take care of their electrolytes too, so that the hydration is maintained. And once the session is over, soon after that, it's better to top up something and then go home. Because most often, a lot of time in the track, okay, or probably you will be strategizing or having a discussion with the coach, and then another extra hour goes there in the court after the practice session is over. Okay, so that is a very good window period one should not lose, and it's very important to carry something. So imagine the car and the fuel, just like how you would top it up from time to time. So what you eat before, during, after is very, very crucial. And why should you bother about food or performance nutrition? Okay, it's just like this. You just have to focus on everyday eating, because it's not about what you eat a week before the tournament is going to start. It's about what you do on a daily basis. Just like how Mr. Leander Pace said, every single day, you know, each and every hour of the practice that you put in, it has a cumulative effect. Likewise, it's the same for the food. And even during lockdown, we've all been talking about how important it is to enhance immunity. So it's not that you start eating healthy food today and tomorrow your immunity is going to like really get better. It doesn't happen overnight. This has to happen over a period of time, and every single day, every meal, the quality that you choose to put into your system matters. And see, we spend quite a lot of money when we build our dream house. It is just like that. The bricks that you choose, the raw material that you buy to build your dream house, is something that you will never compromise on. And you will really go ahead and invest a lot of money. So likewise, this is the temple that you have. So the physical body has to be nurtured with nourishing foods. And that will be one of the most important pillars to perform very well, you know, when the D-Day arrives, right? So I work with a lot of children here. So there will be a lot of reference to child athletes also. So I'll run you through this. Now, fueling is also very, very important. So it's not just the food, it's also the liquids or the hydration, which is of utmost importance. And fueling with the food that tastes good, okay, and also something that you really enjoy. Okay, because there are so many athletes, I know tennis players who actually went to Manila and a lot of European countries, and they really struggled. It's just that the children were not exposed to a whole lot of different cuisines. So my recommendation would always be to the, whether the coaches, the parents or whomever, it's just that as a child is growing up, take them out, okay? And or at least, you know, there should be different foods that they're exposed to, so that they get used to various cuisines and palate and not stick to just the homemade food, because there could be practical difficulties that one could have when they travel abroad for training for months together. If you are working with a coach abroad or else someone from here, say for instance, a South Indian goes to North India and then does some training. So there also there could be challenges. So food is a very important component, and that's why I'm emphasizing so much on this. The role of carbohydrates, protein and fat. So these are the macronutrients. This you definitely need in larger quantities. And most often when it comes to sports nutrition, a lot of people think it's about supplements, it's about protein. Yes, I do agree protein is very important. But what you need is a good amount of carbohydrates so that the protein is left alone to do its job of injury healing as well as muscle growth and maintenance. Then the fluid balance, the hormone synthesis, immune function, and also any kind of surgeries in case somebody has gone through, the recovery will be much faster because of that. Okay, at every aspect. So if you're not taking adequate carbohydrates, because this keto paleo diets have become so popular since 2013. So a lot of people were toying with those kind of low carb, high fat diets. And they actually had a lot of health issues, right? So you really need to work closely with a professional to understand what is important for your body type, because you need to create a template and see at what stage you're able to perform better. So food is your fuel. So see food as fuel, because a lot of people might just eat food when they are stressed, when they're anxious, when they're bored, especially during lockdown phase. Okay. So if you start need adequate carbohydrates for recovery, and also to ensure that you don't have major mood swings, because if the serotonin level, that is one of your neurotransmitter which keeps you nice and happy and healthy. So if you eat a dal chawal, or it's probably a roti and dal and a cup of raita or rice, khadi chawal, when you have all of this, or maybe curd rice. Down south, it's curd rice and potatoes and all that. You actually feel nice. In fact, if you have had curd rice and you sat in a class in school, you would have dozed off like anything. It's just that the serotonin releases and it makes you nice and calm and composed. Okay, so you can manipulate foodstuffs just to pump up your energy. So if you are going in for a session where you really need a lot of energy, where you're really pepped up, focus a lot more on the protein, okay, and reduce a bit of these kind of foods. And towards the night is where you really have your rice and dal and this potato or yam and sweet potatoes in your food along with some meat. Then what happens is you'll really see that you'll sleep very well. And that will help in recovery, and testosterone production also will be perfect, and you will recover beautifully for the session the next day. Okay, I'll show you meal plates and how it is split. You'll be able to see the breakup. Okay, fat is not the villain. It's just that the quality of fat that you choose is very important. So if it is ghee, very ghee, it has to be prepared from the based on grass. So grass-fed cow's milk is more important. So I keep teasing people here down south. So I say, when I see cows, they are chewing cinema posters. They're out on the streets. Okay. So why? Because the cinema posters have cellulose. And that's why the cows, you are actually the ones on the streets, you'll find them grazing on that, or rather eating all of that junk, right? So the best is to look for an organic farm and choose, you know, a good quality organic milk. And if it, and that increases the amount of muscle mass and it reduces the fat percentage. So this is the best thing that you can get when you are getting good fats through your diet. Okay, so it could be flax seeds, chia seeds, sabja seeds, fatty fishes, nuts, almonds, walnuts, pistachios, and all of that. Okay, you needn't go looking for macadamia nuts or else Brazil nuts in case you can't source it. The cashews that you get here are still good. Okay, you can buckle because you will support the local farmer, and you will also get foodstuffs which are not processed or preserved, and it doesn't travel long distances to reach your city. Done. Now this is how a training diet should be. So this is a very, very important to consume a balanced diet. So if you look at this meal plate, you will see there's quite a lot of, and then there are whole grains, okay, and also quite meat, and there are good fats. So when it comes to fats, there's something called as hidden fat or invisible fat. So you, for instance, you know moongfali, right? When you have moongfali, it has oil in it. So that's how we get the groundnut oil. Likewise, when you have a tilka ka chikki, or sesame seed ka chikki, jo hai, when you have that, that also has oil. It's an oil seed, but you can't see it with the naked eye. So it's very important to understand that there are hidden fats. And then there is also the fat that you add while cooking. And there could be a bhaji, bonda, pakoras that you are having. So there also that amount of oil comes in. So watch out, because in case it is an adult athlete where your strength and conditioning coach as well as your coach has, your tennis coach has asked you to keep a watch on the amount of fat and all that, I think one should remember that there are also invisible fats in that. Okay, and fat is not bad. It's just that you need to choose the right amount of fats and get the form. Because if you're working with children, and adolescents have this growth spurt, so they should actually be eating well, because after a point, their epiphyseal plate is going to close. After that, they wouldn't be able to grow any taller. Because I've dealt with a lot of children who were carried away by this thing about supplements, and they were spending 20,000 rupees per month for supplements, and they were weighing food, you know, 75 grams per 100 grams of that. They were eating like that. Each year they hadn't grown any taller. Okay, so there's so much of information. Information explosion is what I would say. There are so many. They just available, or whatever is fancy, or whatever is a fad diet, or being endorsed by a celebrity. Okay, so this is one thing that I would really want you to say. Netflix documentary, The Game Changers, that's another thing, because soon after the documentary was released, I had a whole lot of requests asking for a vegan diet. So that's another story all by itself. Okay, so if you look at this plate, you know, if it's a moderate training day, this will be the breaker. If you could make sure that there is grains, okay, but you will also get a lot of carbohydrates coming in from the vegetables. So if you're having yellow pumpkin, potato, yam, and all of that, it has a lot of starch. Carrot, beetroot has starch, okay, and the rajma, chana, kala chana, whatever you're taking, all the dal varieties that you're having has around 45 to 50% of carbs. So there's quite a lot of carbs sitting in these also. It's roots, the meat, a good combination, and then to ensure that there is fresh fruit, and also add the flavors, any spices. So we use a lot of haldi, ginger, garlic, and all that in our regular cooking. And the rasam that we make down south also has quite a lot of spices, which enhances immunity. And the ones in the north must be having kada. Right, the kada with all these spices are also extremely good. And especially during lockdown, the government has also issued a statement that we really need to focus on having these kind of kada or the kashayams that we call, which are very good for enhancing immunity. So this could be part of a player's diet also. Hard training days is where you see that the ratio of the carbohydrates, so the grains is half the plate. Of carbohydrates is something that's going to really take care of recovery and also you know, help them play without any kind of fatigue and sustain. So the endurance also will be completely enhanced. And in case somebody is not taking meat, it will be good to have a variety of protein rich sources. So for a vegetarian, you have a whole lot of dals, and you also have amaranth or rajgira. That is also a very good source. Okay, if you can't afford quinoa, this is something that one can really bank on. And you also have besan ka chilla, moong ka chilla, you have dokla, khandvi, and a handful of nuts. You can also take roasted Bengal gram, chana jor garam, okay, roasted peas, and kala chana, ghar ka bana hua dal makhni. So all of this. Down south, we have dishes like koota. Koota is nothing but like your palak dal, loki dal, okay? And there's something called as usli, which Tamil Brahmin people have quite a lot. So usli is also something which is a great dish for a paka vegetarian. So, and we call sundal. Sundal is nothing but you just season the kala chana or rajma or else the white chana, kabuli chana, and then just season it with some, do some tadka and then just eat it just like that. And Keralites usually add a generous amount of coconut to that. Okay. So India has a wealth of knowledge about food and all that. It's just that we need to tap its potential. So have a look at this. So there's this anytime meal where if you're really conscious during the lockdown phase, if you want to keep your weight under check or to keep the fat percentage under check and do not want any kind of unnecessary fat gain, then anytime meal is something that one you could look at, because this is where you have quite a lot of vegetables on your plate and then protein that comes in. And drink a lot of water, because when you're sitting at home during lockdown, all the players need to understand that you need to drink adequate water, because we tend to perceive thirst as hunger. Simple terms, if you're feeling hungry, first drink a glass of water, wait for 5-10 minutes. Uske baad, if still that hunger is there, then make sure then you eat. If the hunger subsides, it was never hunger in the first place. Okay, so we tend to perceive this very differently. Post-workout meal should definitely have carbs and protein, have to have so carbohydrates and protein combination. So the best example that I would give would be any of the milkshakes or sandwiches, or it could be idli with some thick sambar, and the sambar should have a lot of vegetables in it, or it could be a porridge. So we make something down south called Saptamavu Kanji, which actually has a whole lot of red rice and then different types of pulses. Nuts like groundnuts are added, badam, cashew, everything. And then this is sprouted, dry roasted, powdered. And this powder is prepared. Just drink around half a liter. So a lot of the kids that I work with, I always put them on this. You know, ghar ka bana hua porridge, and this is like excellent. It's got everything in one shot. Okay, and also there's a lot of people who by choice have become vegans or paka vegetarians. So you just need to sit with a professional to understand how to plan the meal and what works for you. Because if you are a very fussy eater, or if the student or your athlete is quite fussy about certain foodstuffs, it's very difficult to ensure that one doesn't fall into this deficiency. So you really have to work around it. For example, there could be someone with a lactose intolerance, a gluten intolerance, or soy protein allergy, and is a pure vegetarian. So you have very few tools to work out with, and they might require omega-3 or a zinc supplement, okay, or a micronutrient supplement, which will come in handy. So it is very, very important to sit with a professional and get the plan organized, okay? So everyday eating is the... It is important to maximize the glycogen stores. Simple thing, your fuel tank has to be full. Okay, so bus and car as the example that I had taken earlier, before a competition, make sure that the fuel tank is full. So the previous night itself, there should be a nice aloo paratha, or else it can be a homemade fried rice, or else an idli dosa with fish curry or a chicken curry or an egg curry, or it could be dal chawal, or it can be a North Indian style khichdi with curry, any of that, because that's going to top up the carbohydrate stores. And another thing is, there would be a winning formula. I remember playing with working with a tennis player earlier in Chennai, and then, you know, that boy loved pasta. And for him, the day he eats pasta, he goes and plays fabulously well. So there was an emotional connect with that particular dish. Okay, so it's better not to mess up with that. So it'll be good. So I would always say, go ahead, eat that the previous night, you know, enjoy that meal. And psychologically, this also makes a big difference. And don't try anything new, because you don't want any kind of stomach upset. That's another thing. With the children, I've always noticed, you know, bowel movement and all that is a big problem. And you can't take a break and run to the restroom to cleanse your bowels. So all of these factors important, right? And a good mix of these, and don't try anything new before this. And of course, in case someone is highly stressed, and in case the match is going to start at 10, so before they start from home, if they're like so nervous, then it's better to have a smoothie or probably a milkshake or the porridge that I had mentioned earlier. That also works wonders. Okay, so 2 to 4 hours before the competition, if a good meal is eaten, or else a standard staple breakfast is taken, that will help. By the time you get to the court and start playing, this food gets digested and the energy for the team. Now, during competitions are used, so that is one thing that one can take. Okay, but again, you should have tested all this before the competition. So it's very important to work closely with a professional to understand what works best for you. Okay. Another thing, water is definitely good. But if you have extreme sweat losses, then I think you should consider a salt tablets or perhaps even electrolyte drinks. So do all of this during the off-season time, or it's during the time when you don't have any of these tournaments. So what to eat before a workout? So regular practice days, what is it that we should focus on? So the first 50 minutes or 30 minutes, it's better to replace the fluid and the electrolytes. So the easiest thing, you know, before a practice session will be to eat bananas, a handful of nuts. Okay, if you're on the go, best would be to have like a cup of dahi, ghar ka bana hua dahi. I'm not talking about anything fancy. Ghar ka bana hua dahi will be in a lot. If it's tournaments, then it's best to buy those tub yogurt, because it's sick and it doesn't sour. It's neatly packed, doesn't spill. Okay, granola bars are also perfectly fine. Now, within 2 hours, you know, you need to check the weight before and after every practice session to understand your own fluid requirements. And usually, it is always advised to check the color of fluid every time the being packed. Who are all the time carrying their phones, even as they go to the toilet, they carry their phones with them and do not look in the commode. So it's important, you know, that's one thing that I tell a lot of child athletes, the teenagers, kindly do not carry the phone to the toilet. Make sure that you're looking at what you're pooping, and then, you know, also look at the color of urine, because everything matters and they convey quite a lot of messages, right? And the post-competition, you know, so after a practice session or after a game, it is very important to step up. It's like your fuel tank is low and you need to top it up. So this is going to help in recovery. and the sooner the better. So the next 2 hours, 1 to 2 hours after a practice session, this is very, very important. So one needs to plan and everything and carry it. So that's when peanut butter sandwiches helps, or else carrying dry fruits and nuts. Or else it can be something very simple. See, down south, it's so very hot. So I usually ask them to carry some curd rice with them with some pickle. Why pickle? Because pickle, papad, or any of these kind of things have extra salt. And in case you had a lot of sweat, this is the simplest thing to have. And curd is nothing but probiotic, and it takes care of your intestinal health. Okay, so it's very soothing on the stomach. And once the child goes home, they go ahead and then, of course, eat their regular garkha khana, nice and freshly prepared. Okay, this is another thing. So consume foodstuffs which are rich in carbohydrates. That is very, very important, especially after a practice session. Yeah? And also fluid correction, fluids. Those are also very important. Now, because of the lockdown, I thought, this is something that we really need to touch upon. Immune system. Vitamin A is very crucial. If you want, you can just take a picture. I'm just going to run through. And of course, vitamin C. And you also have vitamin E. All the nuts and seeds and oils. Zinc is also very important to enhance vitamin C. Excellent source. Magnesium. This, in fact, prevents cramping. So magnesium supplements are given to ensure that a player doesn't cramp, and it has worked very well. I have worked with Mr. Balachandran's wards or students, and magnesium is something that was missing. So if the soil is pretty depleted, the food might not have adequate ones, or if a person is not taking any of this. So commonly used to prevent cramping. These are things which are easily available in our kitchen. Very good if you can make a kashayam or else a kada and then drink. During lockdown and even post-lockdown, I think this entire year, we really need to be very, very careful. And this is going to raise the immunity. These are the vegetarian sources. So pulses and lentils, and then of course, soybeans and all that, nuts and seeds. And as I mentioned earlier, there is also, all the besan chilla, moong chilla, adai, pesarattu. Pesarattu is eaten in Andhra. It's green gram dosa, and that's excellent. So you consider that. Amaranthia, rajgira is also very good. Down south, a lot of millets are used, and that's absolutely gluten-free. That's the best part, okay? So this is the healthy plate. I'm just going to go for the gluten thing. I really want to tell you, see, gluten is one thing that became very popular after Djokovic shared his experiences. I'll give you a simple example. There was a client of mine who, in spite of, drinking adequate water, eating foodstuffs before, during, after, he was still feeling tired, and his blood levels of iron was really low. Okay. The main problem was nothing but gluten. I put him on a gluten-free and a dairy-free diet. And then we were able to see how he started absorbing all the foodstuffs that he was taking. All the nutrients were reaching his blood. So what happens in gluten? Simple example. If you have a petrol car, will you put diesel in it or kerosene in it? Will it work? It won't, right? So you need to give the right fuel. Okay, so you could be an international level player or anybody, right? But if you do not understand your own body type, if you haven't studied your body type and then you put the wrong fuel, what happens with gluten is, it's just that there is a lot of inflammation in the small intestine. And because of this inflammation, even if you've eaten iron-rich food, calcium-rich food, there is no absorption. So your blood doesn't get any of these nutrients and you'll have a lot of discomfort. So how do you know what is gluten intolerance? How do you identify it? These are the symptoms. I had it 10, 15 years back. I had it. So that's why I'm sharing this story. And bloating, diarrhea, constipation. And then if you're passing gas all the time, and if it is smelly gas, I think you really need to suspect all of this. Abdominal pain, headaches, breathing, asthma-like, breathing difficulty, which is exactly what Djokovic felt, okay? And sometimes because of this, there'll also be a feeling of depression because you're not absorbing the nutrients and there could be gross deficiency at the cellular level. And if that is not being rectified, then definitely you will exhibit these kind of symptoms also. And unexplained anemia. I remember how P.T. Usha had mentioned sometime back how, in her heydays, her hemoglobin level was always suboptimal. I think there could have been a food allergy. Okay. And most Asians have even lactose intolerance, which just go undetected. And we just latch onto our teas and coffees and we do not want to give it up. Okay. So this also could be a big issue. And there are so many options. There are so many options. Even if you're lactose intolerant, you can easily go ahead and work around it, not a problem. And you know what the best news about gluten is? See, forget the wheat, barley, rye, but you have a whole lot of other things. You can have thalipeet. Okay, you can have a whole lot of jawar, bajra, all those rotis. All those are perfectly fine. And you can make dosas out of millets, okay, idlis, and then vermicelli. All these are available in the market. So it's like really easy. You can have poha. So the options are plenty for an Indian, and all your rajgira and besan chilla, moong chilla are also gluten-free. Okay, so that's the best part. You can go ahead and take this, and it's very easy for an Indian to make this transition beautifully. And even for lactose, okay, so these are the symptoms for lactose intolerance. You could have bloating, gas, pain in the abdomen, passing quite a lot of gas, and there could be symptoms of acidity also. Okay, even that could happen. And these are the alternatives. Okay, soy milk, rice milk, hemp milk, cashew milk, almond milk, coconut milk. So there are so many resources in India itself. You can work around it. Not a problem. Just sit with a professional work and you can really sort this out. Okay, so I'll tell you what happens is, you know, if your gut and your brain has a strong connection. So if your intestines are not okay, if you're feeling a lot of discomfort, okay, it will really give you a lot of brain fog. You won't have clarity in thought. You won't be able to strategize your game. Okay, you'll have a brain fog. Okay, why? Because like I've gone through this 10 years back, and then as I was talking to a client, my eyes just closed. I was so embarrassed. It is just that my energy levels were so low in spite of 8 hours of sleep. And I had to figure this out myself with a food diary, do an elimination test. And that's when I figured out it was the wheat which was causing trouble. Okay. And once it was over, it was as though a brain fog was just lifted. Okay. So it was such a fantastic experience in just 2 weeks' time. That's it. Okay. So these are all the vegetarian sources. You can play around with anything. Okay. Hydration, very important. I need to emphasize more. All of you know that. The color chart helps a lot to educate the children, the child athletes. All of this really makes a big difference. Another thing is also overhydration. No one talks about it. Okay, overhydration can kill a person. That can really happen. So that's why I shared. I had this good fortune of meeting Tim Noakes, Professor Tim Noakes from Cape Town, while I was working in Sri Ramachandra Medical College. And this gentleman was a big proponent of low-carb, high-fat diets. In fact, I sometimes work with clients and put them, you know, while they are on off-season, I put them on a low-carb, high-fat diet to adults, only adult athletes, after a comprehensive blood test. But then before the season starts, again, I start loading them with carbs. So you should know when to do what. And that's the most important thing. And I always tell the athletes, any player that I'm working with, you know, figure out what suits you. You get your shirts tailored. You get your trousers tailored. Likewise, food tailored, and create your own template. And when you eat that food, you will be able to perform extremely well. And you hit your best at that time. Okay? So you great. When someone looks at you, your face is nice and bright. Your eyes are sparkling. Okay? And your hair and nails and skin is glowing. Right? So those are all ways in which, in fact, it reflects your good health. And plus, you're able to recover from your games. You're able to do your best when your SNC coach is giving sessions, right? So the gym, you're able to do justice in the court, all of this. So I think that's peak performance, and food plays a big role. Sleep disturbances. This is another crucial thing that I really wanted to share, because sleep disturbance, it's a big problem with athletes, youngsters, all of them. It's just that you do not go to sleep and melatonin doesn't get released. So if you're constantly looking at the phone, so the blue light is going to hit your eye, and this is going to prevent the cortisol or the stress hormone to come down. Only if this comes down, the melatonin or the sleep hormone comes up. And once that happens, you will sleep well. About sleep, I really have to tell you, it's not about 8 hours of sleep. It's about going to bed at 10 o'clock and waking up at 5 or 5:30 or 6. It's about being in alignment with the circadian rhythm. Okay, so there is sunrise, sunset, there's nature, and we need to be in alignment with the nature. And we all know during the lockdown period, see how nature has played in all of our lives. You know, one tiny virus that has really put the entire world on a standstill, right? So you can't mess up with this nature. Right. So if you're in alignment with nature, and if you go to bed at 10, what happens is 10 to 2 a.m., your body undergoes repair. And 2 a.m. to 6 a.m., your mind undergoes repair. And when you mess this up, what happens is insulin, leptin, ghrelin, three hormones get disturbed completely, and you end up getting a lot of sugar cravings. So when you're looking at, or like, you know, thinking about the cakes and the ice creams and all the, you know, kesari and the sweets, you won't be able to connect or link the food with the sleep that you're messing up with. Another factor is you could be exercising quite a lot, expecting a good amount of muscle mass to come. But then if you're not sleeping on time, if you're not sleeping between that window period, what happens is your growth hormone and your testosterone get really messed up, or in the sense, when you sleep well, these two secrete properly and you will have better enhancements. You will see hypertrophy of muscles happening. Okay, so do not mess up the foundation. This is the most crucial thing. And sleep is very, very important. So for you to sleep at 10, you need to be in bed by 9:30. By the time you toss around and all that and kind of settle down, you will really sleep well by 9:45, 10. Important. Another thing is magnesium helps you sleep well. So the ones who are having trouble with magnesium, include some pumpkin seeds, have some quinoa, or probably consider chamomile tea. That is also a great one to help you sleep. Okay. So all this could happen if you're not sleeping well. You can make a lot of mental errors, judgment. And Mr. Leander Pace very clearly emphasized on emotional fitness and then mental fitness. He said 75-80%. That's brilliant. Okay. So I guess for that to happen, your gut and brain has a connection. So what you eat, what you absorb, what reaches your bloodstream, do you see the connection there? So this is where food plays a part. And another thing I want to tell you for coaches, okay, this is the last slide. I would really love to take questions. The most important thing when you're working with a female athlete, okay, I know there are so many coaches out there, and you have such a fantastic rapport, because these students do not come and meet the physiotherapist or a dietitian very often. Coaches are like God, and they will listen to anything they say. Okay, they might not even listen to the parents, but they will come and really have this beautiful relationship with the coaches. And what they say is the final word, right? They literally worship you people. So I have few pointers for all of you. Kindly ask them these questions. First thing, do they go to the toilet every single morning? Because I work with children, I find them that, you know, they do not go to the toilet in the morning. They're not eating adequate vegetables. So I always emphasize on minimum of 300 grams of vegetables and 5 fruits a day. Eat local fruits, nothing fancy like kiwi, green apple, nothing. Eat what is available in India, in your city, in your town. Okay, eat local. Eat a lot of vegetables, then the proper download will happen first thing in the morning. Otherwise, while they are doing their practice session, they might ask for a break, run to the toilet, and then come back and again start playing. And they will be embarrassed. You wouldn't like, because the 1 hour in the court is very important for you as a coach. And there are other students who are coming there, right? None of you want to waste your time. So please check with these kids or ask them to maintain a journal. Menstrual cycle. If you're working with female athletes, kindly ask if they are they're getting their monthly periods. Ask them to maintain a record. And these days you have a lot of apps in the phone that they can use. Why should you be worried? Because if they're not taking adequate energy, because these kids could go ahead and then cut calories without telling you, without meeting a nutritionist or somebody, you know, they can just go on a completely different diet, cut calories drastically, whereas you might have increased the volume and the intensity of the game, the practice sessions. And if the energies do not match up, their growth is going to be compromised. And the body thinks that very little energy is coming. This person is because the body's job is to keep your heart, liver, kidney function working 24/7, and it sees periods as an unnecessary energy expenditure. It will shut it down. Okay, so and if that happens, there will be a lot of injury, soft tissue injury, the bones will become weak, they'll have a lot of injuries. So if there is a girl who's having continuous injuries, and then if she's not getting her regular periods, you should be worried. And do not hesitate to ask this girl, are you getting your periods regularly? Okay, so I think this is a very important thing. And talk to any of the child and ask whether do you have any gut disturbances, bloating, flatulence, burping, acidity, diarrhea, constipation, because these could be an underlying problem, or rather the underlying problem could be food intolerance. Okay, it could be lactose or gluten intolerance. So this is important. And once this is done, they'll do remarkably well. Amazing difference. Recovery, sleep, bedtime, very crucial. So they could probably maintain a food journal and then include all these factors also and show it to you before they leave. every day. So make sure that these kids are taking and supplement usage. So very simple, supplement is like a icing on the cake. Okay, we eat the cake. Okay, the cake is the basics about going to bed on time, eating healthy food, following sports nutrition principles, hydration guidelines. Okay, this decoration, the fondant and all those decorations on the cake, the icing is just supplement. Okay, so they need to understand before 18, they do not need these kind of supplements. They can have all the mutton soups, eat organ meat, eat a healthy, well-balanced diet and in a good quantity and work with a professional. That's it. Do you have any questions? I would love to take them.
Thank a lot. Thanks a lot, Shiny. That was a phenomenal presentation. You shared so much of knowledge with us. And the most important thing was it was not too technical and you were able to connect it to the practical foods and what, you know, it is so easy for people, to the coaches especially, to understand all the information that you shared. Fantastic. And congratulations for that. And very good communication as well.
Thank you so much.
May I ask Shiny a question, please?
Of course, Leander. You're welcome.
Shiny, thank you so much for all this information. It's been really cool, especially that sleep part, because I struggle with sleep with all the time difference that we go through a 40-week calendar. The question that I have for you is that as one gets older, how does one quicken or maintain one's body metabolism to burn food? Are there any food products, or is there something that one can do to keep our metabolism going faster?
Okay, so you must have done your body composition analysis, right? You know exactly your fat percentage and lean body mass. Okay, you could probably, during off season, you can try a low carb high fat diet. That's one strategy. I'll tell you what I did. This was one of those cricketer from Gujarat. Yeah. So during the off season, we actually worked on reducing the carbohydrate, but increasing the protein, good fats, and of course the vegetable. I worked around with this. What had happened is when you reduce the carbohydrate, the body will switch over and use fat as a source of energy. And that will really help for you to change these parameters, and you will reduce the fat percentage and the muscle mass. You will be simultaneously exercising. So the lean musculature is maintained, and getting protein with each meal becomes very important, and add the good fats. So that is where that spoon of butter, that little bit of coconut, drinking coconut oil in the morning, or perhaps even including apple cider vinegar or lemon juice to every dish that you consume. Okay, so all this, because when you add an acidic medium, the body will ensure that you do not have the sugar spikes. Okay, the glycemic index of the food itself will be maintained very well. Basically, it's about trying to keep the insulin under check. So if you have a good chunk of time where you can rework your body composition, reduce the fat percentage, because the idea is to keep the percentage varies. So the protein could be anywhere between 40 to 50%. Good fats could be 20 to 30 and the rest could be carbs. And before stepping into the season, go ahead and reintroduce the carbohydrates there. And as you mentioned, sleep, I think one is gadget usage. Okay. Next thing is also ensuring that you get some magnesium citrate. There are specific salts that would really help. Magnesium is something that you could consider. Some even add some Epsom salt and then dip their feet in it. That could be considered. Chamomile tea is easily available. You could take that also. And a lot of us tend to cut out grains at night. I think that's the biggest mistake a lot of people do. So if you want to cut the carbs, at least for lunch, eat the meat and the vegetables and the dal. Okay. But for dinner, keep the dinner at around 6:30, 7. But eat khichdi, quinoa, bisbele bath, or have idlis, dosas, chawal, whatever it is, because the carbohydrates will release the serotonin and you will sleep like a baby. You will really see the
effect. Thank you very much.
Biggest mistake we do is we have soup and then tandoori chicken, or else fish tikka, chicken tikka, or the grills. So when the carbs are not there for dinner, it messes up with our sleep.
You're making me hungry with all the food talk, but thank you very much.
So, okay. Thank you, Leander. That was a fantastic question, actually. And thank you, Shiny.
Thank you.
We have a few questions from the attendees. The first one is regarding vegetarian diet and a non-veg diet. Does a tennis player have to eat non-vegetarian to get all the protein requirements, or can you satisfy it with just vegetarian diet?
Okay, how old is this person? Is there any specification given, Mr. Suresh?
No, this is a general question that everybody is asking. People who are vegetarians, they are asking, should I convert to a non-vegetarian to perform in tennis? Is a vegetarian good enough? This is a question that goes around, especially in India.
Okay, they might need some supplements. I'm being very honest. They might need some omega-3, some zinc. Okay, and selenium, magnesium, chromium, manganese, these are things which are very, very important. And another thing is, we really need to know the entire food cycle. Okay, you need to know where your food is coming from. Is the food grown in a soil where there is crop rotation? Because in, if you know, in the 1980s and 90s and all, if there was paddy being harvested in a field, once that is over, there will be pulses which are grown. Pulses will go ahead and fix the nitrogen from the atmosphere. So nitrogen gets fixed. Then the next phase, once this is harvested, the paddy is, you know, cultivated. So when you do crop rotation, this entire cycle happens beautifully. Whatever the soil is depleted by the paddy comes back with the pulses. But these days there's a lot of mono rotation, which means only paddy grows in that particular field. When you do mono rotation, and if you're not following ancient traditional method of farming, the soil will be quite depleted. And another factor is, where is the food coming from? How far is it coming from? Is this the product that's coming from another city, another country, and the shipping and all of that, by the time it comes to the warehouse and to your local market, then wahan se kharid ke hum fridge pe rakhte hain, and by the time we cook, it will be a week. Okay, so you really don't know how much of nutrients are sitting there. Okay, so that's why I said supplements. So buy from the local market. Okay, so if you have a shandy, if you have a local vegetable market, go support that guy and ensure that he's practicing good farming techniques, and support that guy and source food from there. Then you're getting the maximum out of it. Okay, another thing is to first eliminate any kind of food allergy or intolerance, because even if you're eating nutritious food, you might not absorb it if there is a problem with the gut. So your gut or intestine is very, very important. So you go to an Ayurvedic Vaidya or any Siddha or any tradition. First, they will cleanse your bowels, colon cleanse. Uske baad they'll give medicines. So it is so very important for you to absorb. So these two factors are very crucial. You can be a vegetarian, but sit with a nutritionist to understand how to do the combinations right. Then it's fine.
Yeah. Right. Thank you, Shani. See, the general feeling is like, you know, everybody is an expert when it comes to food. Your grandmother, your mother, your sister, your brother, everyone. And people don't understand the science behind this nutrition. Can you throw some light about how specific your diet has to be to an individual? What are the parameters you take into account? The different sport they play, even if they're playing only tennis, the kind of training they could be going through. It could be strength, it could be something else, you know. So how do you differentiate, or what are the parameters you take into account to be specific, you know, to when you prescribe for a particular individual?
Very good question. Thank you, Mr. Suresh, for asking. Okay, so we do an assessment. So during the assessment, we ask about, you know, who cooks the food? Where is the food sourced? Who goes to the market? Okay, and what is your ethnic background? Okay, are you a Bengali living in Chennai? Or a Kannadiga living in Gujarat, okay? These things matter. What did you eat as a child? And also the regular pattern of eating. Right from morning till evening, what do you eat Monday to Friday? And then weekend. Because weekend is a different ballgame altogether. Dealing with teenagers or 20 plus, weekend could be going to a pub, or it's just chilling at home. They end up eating, drinking, and everything goes in. So, okay. And whether when they pass motion, is it rope shaped, or is it like is it semi solid? We've asked these questions also because it's a lot of information for me, for us, you know, as nutritionists. You need, because the ideal thing, if you have noticed, the old-fashioned general physicians, they will look at all this and then only give the prescription. So there could be symptoms, or they're being very tired and haggard. So all is also noted. Age, gender, male or female, and then of course the intensity, all this is taken into account. Plus also, where is the house, where is the school or college or the office, and what is the distance to the tennis court? And in the morning, what is the traffic? What is the distance taken to reach the tennis court? What is the distance in the evening? Because in traffic, there could be a lot of time wasted, and recovery also gets affected because of that. And if there is any cramping history, if there is an injury history. So all these things are taken, and then a diet plan is. Another factor is also, there's no one diet chart. With just one diet chart, one visit to the nutritionist, nothing is going to change. You'll pick up a few concepts. So usually what I do is I work with them for a period of time and teach them, give them all possible education. And after a point, they should not look for a dietitian. They should be on their own. So making them independent, know what to read, how to read a label, learn to cook some meals, because I always tell the parents, teach your boys how to cook. Because when they travel to different countries, and if they need some desi food, they can toss up a meal and they'll have that, you know, feeling of goodness. Another factor is also, you know, what kind of foods to eat if you're going to a chaat shop, to a movie theater, or if you're going to a pub, okay? Or if you have a lot of weddings coming up. So ask the parents to go ahead and take the kids to different restaurants. So Thai, Mexican, any kind of continental global cuisine, so that tomorrow if they're traveling to some country, they really need to get comfortable with the various cuisines. Okay, so there's a lot of detail that goes in. See, grandma's nuske jo hai, those are good, no doubt, but there is a little science also behind it. So I think it will be a good marriage if we consider what our ancient system is and then understand the Western concept. So my approach has been understanding Western concepts, but customizing it to the desi player.
Okay. Yeah, that's very insightful. Yeah, definitely when the players travel around, one of the biggest problems they face is the food to adjust. You go to Thailand, you go to, you know, the food is just not the same. It's so different. Unless you understand the fundamentals, and if you eat right, only then your performance is going to take care of itself. Otherwise, there's going to be a big issue. We have a Vikas Rana. He's asking, can you please suggest some natural homemade hydrates that can be used during practice and matches, other than water and not Glucon-D?
Okay, fine. I'll tell you. Is this during the game, Mr. Rana? Are you asking during the game or after?
Before, during, and after.
Okay, fine. If it is before, let me tell you. Very simple. You just have to ensure that coconut water is very good. You can try that. If it is someone who perspires quite a lot, you can probably ask them to top it up with this thing, electrol. You could consider electrol in a worst case scenario. Fine. Another thing is also squash. So take 250 ml of squash, dilute it with 750 ml of water, and add a pinch of salt. You know how these sport drinks taste? It's very dilute. So if a guest comes home, you'll make a lemon juice, which will be quite sweet, right? It shouldn't be of that concentration, because that is called as a hypertonic drink. It has to be isotonic. Isotonic is the solution and the fluids inside your body are of the same osmolality. So simple thing, taste a sport drink. Understand how dilute it is. Prepare it with squash. Take squash, run it through, and then add some salt. Job done. This can be your simple sport drink. You can have this little before and then during the game. After the game, what you can do is, you can actually have a lot of your desi drinks. See, down south, we have something called as panagam. Okay, so panagam is nothing but during summer, what we do is the pot, we store water in the pot, mud pot, and it's nice and chill. And then we add dry ginger, lemon, jaggery. Because jaggery has a little bit of iron and it also has salt. Okay. Also squeeze in lemon. So the vitamin C comes in. Ginger is good for digestion. Right. So you mix up all this and then drink. So this kind of a concentrated drink, or you can even water it down, this can be taken after the game. during the game, it's better to stick to isotonic. After the game, you can take something a little more sweeter, that is still okay. And you can also have lemon juice with salt and sugar, okay? And any of the squash, as I said. And after the practice session of the game will be porridges. So as I said, this multi-grain porridge mix. See, down south, it's called a sattu mavu kanji, okay? But you can call this a health mix. I'm sure it's available across the country. You will find this online. If you need any information, feel free to contact me. I'll share the recipe stuff that we make at home. And also ragi porridges and all that can be taken after the game. Or it could be a banana milkshake or an apple milkshake. In case the person has a lactose intolerance, apple, then a handful of soaked badam or cashew, add water, blend it, and then just gulp it down. Add some natural sugar. So jaggery will also help. Hope I've answered your question.
Yeah, Vikas is very happy. Shaini, you spoke about having water 10 or 15 minutes before food, and you told the reasons why you do that. Now, there's also a lot of myth going around about drinking water during and after food. People say that, oh, you shouldn't drink water while you're eating, or some people will say that after you eat, you should wait for a while, you shouldn't drink water. You know this. You know how people are. Everybody's an expert and everybody gives advice. Can you give us some scientific reasons why and what should do?
I'm glad you asked this question. You know, that's the biggest problem that we're all facing. Anyone who eats a 3-square meal thinks it's a nutritionist. And there are a lot of quacks around. Okay, so I would recommend that all of you go and check the Indian Dietetic Association website, idaindia.com. Okay, this is very important because it tells you who a real dietitian is. Very, very important for all of you because there are so many quacks around. Someone might just lose weight, okay, and then go ahead and claim themselves to be nutritionists. So we are battling that. Okay, besides that, let's come to this. The main thing is about, what was your question? I'm sorry, I'm so spaced out now.
About drinking during food and yes, drinking after food.
Yeah. Okay. See, traditionally, if you look at a meal, you will have buttermilk, rasam, or there would be some liquid that we have. Patla sa wo chas jo hai, wo to hum lete hi hai. Right? So yeah. We do drink this buttermilk, which is part of our culture, which is always there in our diet. So the only thing is don't drink 1 liter of water before drinking or having a meal. The idea is to make sure that you just take sips of water. So before 15 minutes, drink a glass of water if you want. That's perfectly fine. And along with the meal, there'll be some buttermilk, or down south people have rasam, which is great for digestion. And when you have watery vegetables like white pumpkin or else cucumbers and all that, it already has water in it. Okay, so this is all part of a traditional meal, and there are different schools of thought, food combinations and all that. So we really need to look at the basics and see where this is coming from. You can drink water 15 minutes before a meal. During the meal, have buttermilk or any of this rasam or the liquids that is part of your food. That's what I would say. Not a problem at all. You can take it. And an athlete's requirements are much different from a non-athlete.
Okay. And after food?
After food, don't gulp water. Wait for at least half an hour. Because if you've eaten a good meal and then taken some buttermilk and rasam, I think it's good, right? That's more than enough. You don't need. You can probably take half a glass of water just to wash down the flavor in your mouth. And that's it. Do not drink 1 liter soon after eating a meal. Okay. Perhaps that could be avoided. And hydration has to be staggered throughout the day. It shouldn't be all towards one particular time of the day. That's not good.
Yeah, absolutely. One Mahendra Varman wants to know, can you shed some light on leaky gut syndrome? Does it have anything to do with gluten?
Yes. Thank you so much for asking. A very interesting question. Yes, there is an issue. So what happens is, so the intestinal cells which are there, they're very tightly packed. Okay. And when we take drugs without prescription from a physician, or, over the counter, you buy a lot of supplements and take it. Or if you take alcohol on an empty stomach, there's a whole lot of medications, alcohol. It could be a longstanding acidity or gastritis, and also food intolerance. And you didn't know that you had an intolerance and went ahead to take a lot of gluten in the daily diet or lactose. This can happen. So you need to work with the gastroenterologist and side by side also work with a nutritionist to fix the diet. Yes, because you need a lot of extra supplements to help the gut heal. So you will need MCT, which is coconut oil, and then also some glutamine and some bone broth, because until this gets, because affect performance, it can lead to anemia, which means fatigue, lack of recovery, and all of that. These things are very important, and you need to sort this out by working control.
Okay, thanks a lot, Shiny. We ran out of time. There was a phenomenal session by you and answering questions. We have a whole lot of other questions. So what you can do is you can share your contacts and whatever. And if people want to ask, can they ask you, send you an email or something?
Do I type?
Yeah.
I have a website. I don't know.
You could just type it into the chat. Your mobile number and your email ID and or whatever contact you'd like to share.
Yeah, Instagram handle also.
Yeah.
So I do a live session every evening at 6. Chandran is my maiden name. After marriage is Surendran. So that's me. You'll find me on Facebook too at the same name. So Shiny Surendran. Okay, so if you have any queries, please feel free. To text me, to reach out. I'll be more than happy to give the information.
Yes.
So go local, eat desi food, eat what belongs to India, and meet a qualified nutritionist.
Yes, that's the most important thing. So thanks a lot, Shiny, and it was great having you here, and thank you for, and I have to thank Balu also to bringing you in on this program.
Yeah, thank you so much, Balu sir. Thank you so much, Mr. Suresh. Thank you, and thank you, AITA and Sports Authority of India, for having me here. Such a wonderful opportunity to meet all of you. Thank you. Such
thank
a pleasure.
You.
Well done, Shiny. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Thank you.
Yeah. And all the participants, we have some good news for you. Mr. Miguel Crespo, the head of participation and coaching of the International Tennis Federation, will be giving a presentation for all of us tomorrow. This is going to be an amazing thing. I don't know if you all know Miguel Crespo, if you had known him as a person, as a presenter, he's the one who started the coaches education program in India. He's the one who initiated this, and the whole education program is his baby. He's the person who's written all the books. He's written books on psychology, he's written books on fitness, he's written books on tactics, technique, everything connected to tennis. He's a phenomenal individual, and it will be a revelation to listen to him talk tomorrow. And do not miss this. I repeat again, do not miss this session. He's going to talk about the continuous development, professional development of a coach. So tomorrow, the timing is going to be different. It's not going to be at 10 a.m. It's going to be at 3 p.m. tomorrow, because 10 a.m. is too early for Spain. So we'll be starting tomorrow at 3 p.m. I repeat, not 10 a.m. in the morning. We'll be starting at 3 p.m. in the afternoon. And tomorrow's guests are going to be our Davis Cup captain, Rohit Rajpal, and Vishal Uppal. And I once again have to thank Leander still here for staying for the entire session. Leander, it was amazing to have you for the entire session.
Thanks, Suresh. It's been really interesting, the conversation back and forth, looking at the questions and the comments on the message section.
Yeah.
And also Shiny emphasizing on sleep and on metabolism. I struggle with sleep a lot, and
okay.
To actually look at the hours that's there between 10 and 2 to get that quality sleep,
mm-hmm.
Is important. So really fun to be here. I'm going to take your leave and say goodbye. But all of you guys, stay safe, stay happy. Spend quality time with your family and your loved one. And once again, thank you so much, Sports Authority of India and AITA. God bless.
Thanks a lot, Lee. So now you have your one last question somebody wanted to ask you. Are you going to extend this last road for a while, or how long are you going to be around in the circuit?
I know that's not for Shiny. I was going to give her that question. But it's a big evaluation that the team's doing just now, because I'm 3 Grand Slam participations away from playing in 100 Grand Slams. So that's another world record I'd like to have for India. Yeah. And also the Olympics have been postponed from this summer to 2021. That's a goal there. But I think right now the call of the day, Suresh, is about staying safe, staying happy, practicing hygiene, taking care of our bodies, our minds, and our emotional fitness. Yeah. And I think that once the lockdown opens up and once tennis starts again, which I think is pretty much done for the rest of this year, I think it's going to be very hard to travel to international countries and play tennis in 2020. My humble understanding, it will be in 2021. So I'll evaluate this towards the end of the year once the lockdown opens up, I think.
Okay. We definitely want to see you around in the Grand Slams, and we are all here to support you. You want some energy? Yeah. We are here.
I'm actually going to call you a little later to get Shiny's number. I need a little bit of help with my diet and my metabolism stuff, and sleep, so it'll be nice to interact. But these sort of sessions are really wonderful to keep us motivated. You know, after doing this for 30 years, for me, the mental motivation is really important. So thanks for putting this together today.
Thank you, Lee. I'll message the number to you. Thank you, and bye-bye. See everybody, and see you all tomorrow at 3 p.m. It's not 10 a.m. Okay, it's going to be Miguel Crespo of the International Tennis Federation tomorrow. See you all at 3 p.m. Bye, and take care, and stay safe. Bye.